In this video, we're going to talk a little bit about measuring radiation, the units that we use to measure it, and a little bit about how we measure it, just a little bit. So the tool that we most commonly use to measure radiation is called a Geiger counter, and the basic Geiger counter works something like this. It has a tube filled with a gas, like maybe argon gas, and it has an opening, well, a covered opening so the gas can't escape, but something that radiation can pass through easily. And When radiation passes through and hits these atoms of argon gas, or whatever the gas is, it ionizes it. That means it knocks an electron off. And that creates a positively charged atom, like an argon with a plus charge, and an electron. Now, in this tube, there's a positive end and a negative end. And anything with a negative charge will be pulled towards the positive end, anything with a positive towards the negative end. And when you create these things with charges, the Geiger counter itself, there's a signal that's sent up this wire to the Geiger counter, and that causes the Geiger counter to make a sound. The more radiation that hits, the more charged particles there are, the more clicks that you hear on a Geiger counter. That's basically, roughly how a Geiger counter works. Now, the different types of radiation that we've seen, basically the alpha particles, beta particles, and the gamma rays, what this table does is it shows you about how far they can travel through the air. Alpha particle, not very far, 2 to 4 centimeters. A beta particle can go 2 to 3 meters, and a gamma ray can go 0.5 kilometer. So that's pretty far. How far do they penetrate into biological tissue? Well, an alpha particle, not very far, like a 0.5 of a millimeter, not very far, just the surface, whereas a beta particle can go 4 or 5 millimeters in. That's enough to do some damage. And whereas a gamma ray can basically go straight through a human being, 0.5 of a meter. And the way you shield against these different particles, paper or clothing, just something thin like that will shield an alpha particle. For a beta particle, you need, really heavy clothing, lab coats, gloves, things like that. Whereas to shield a gamma ray, you need lead or thick concrete. So the units that we use when we're talking about radiation depend upon what we're talking about that radiation doing. The common units we use for what's called activity. Activity is just how much of that of an isotope, of a sample of an isotope, is decaying per second. And the more common unit, which we'll talk about, is called the curie. The symbol is a capital C, lowercase I. So 1 curie is equal to 3.7 times 10 to the 10th disintegrations per second, or decays per second. In other words, that many isotopes decaying per second is 1 curie. And that number corresponds to the disintegration rate of 1 gram of radium, a radioactive isotope of radium. And so if something had an activity of 2 curies, it would be twice this. Or we could have the SI prefixes like micro or milli. If it's 1 millicurie, it's 1,000th of this, or 10 to the 7th, 3.7 times 10 to the 7th. All right, so that's activity. That's the unit we'll use. Now, how much now absorbed dose, radiation absorbed dose, the rad. This measures how much energy is hitting whatever is being irradiated per gram of the irradiated material. So it's joules, which is energy, per gram. And this gram is not grams of the isotope, but rather grams of whatever the radiation is hitting, your body or maybe a detector or something like that. And that's about 1 times 10 to the minus 5th joules per gram. So that's different from activity. Activity is how many of these isotopes are decaying per second. Absorbed dose, or rad, that's how much energy is hitting 1 gram of the radiated material. Now, we also have biological damage, or the REM. And this is a measure of the damage that radiation can do. And it's how much energy hits per gram, a rad, times the RBE, radiation biological equivalent. And the RBE is just a factor that you multiply the number of rads by. And it depends upon what kind of radiation there is. If it's an X-ray, a beta ray, or a gamma ray, then the RBE is just 1. And so the amount of damage, the REM, that it can do is the same as the number of rads. If it's a high energy proton or neutron, then the RBE is 10, so you multiply the number of rads times 10, so it can do more damage. And if it's an alpha particle, then the RBE is 20, and you multiply the number of rads times 20 to get how much damage or the rems that it can do. So we have activity, absorbed dose, and biological damage. These three units measure different things. So because activity depends upon how much of an isotope is present, we can treat it just like we can amount of the isotope. So when we were doing half-life calculations, we talked about if we initially had this many grams of an isotope, how many grams would be left, for example. We can talk about it the same way, but in terms of activities. So if we have this much activity to begin with, after this much time, what's the activity? It's going to depend upon the half-life, just like the amount did. So let's do an example. So given that the half-life for cerium-141 is 32.5 days, and if we have a sample of cerium-141 that now currently has an activity of 8.0 microcuries, remember this micro means times 10 to the minus 6, so it's a smaller amount of cu- and then, so anyway, if the activity after 130 days is 8 microcuries, what's the initial activity in microcuries? Well, we set it up just like we did with the other half-life problems. And there's two ways we can do it, just like before, and we'll talk about both of those. But first, no matter what, we have to find out how many half-lives have gone by. Well, 130 days have passed, and we know that there's 32.5 days per every one half-life. So if you just divide the two numbers, it tells us that four half-lives have gone by. So one way to do it would be to kind of work our way backwards, okay? So if we now have 8 microcuries, so that would be after 4 half-lives. So if we double that times 2, 8 times 2 is 16, that means after 3 half-lives there was 16 microcuries. Double the 16 is 32, so after 2 half-lives there was 32 microcuries of activity. And then double that's 64. That means after 1 half-life there were 64 microcuries of activity. So if we double that one more time, 128, or we get 2 sig figs, so around to 130 microcuries was the initial activity. Or we can use the formula, just like we did on the other problem. That is, if we take the initial amount, or in this case, the initial activity, times 1 half raised to the power of however many half-lives have gone by, that's equal to how much we have left, the activity, the current activity. In this case, we're solving for the initial activity. In the problem that we did before, we solved for, I believe, how much was left. So if we just divide both sides by 1 half to the fourth power, we can take 8 divided by 1 half to the fourth power. And you guys should put this in your calculator, make sure you get the same number. And this gives us 128 microcuries, which again, 2 sig figs because of this 8.0 rounds to 130 microcuries of initial activity.